carpet, for, of course, you know, to camouflage stain. At the same time, it became a metaphor for the town hall where the carpet was put in, because the town hall basically became the platform, you know, how to handle data of the citizens. And now this is another obsession. Francisco. And again, here I think you see kind of the playfulness, or let's say the seriousness of these seats. Of course, they can be, you know, enjoyed, you know, as an interactive element. But also, again, it talks about how we leave traces. There's nothing like an innocent architectural surface anymore. Everywhere we go, you know, there's a certain information that we leave behind. And if this was, let's say, new material in our speculation on how that affects how we read space or how we create space. It also then flips back into things like izaza, glass, mosaic tiles, where we like to see new potential in traditional elements, traditional materials. In this case, we were asked by izaza to do a lounge for a design week. And I always liked when these glass tiles come, you know, on sheets of paper or fabric, and they remain this kind of elasticity. And so we developed, again, seating elements where if you sit down, they become kind of soft and elastic because they're glued onto foam, polyurethane foams. But they would look quite hard and cold when you see them. So again, this idea of surprise, which also happens in the temperature-sensitive furniture pieces, I think is a very truthful moment, because surprise, for me, is the very moment where you react in a very immediate, non-kind of educated, or no, like in a moment without any prejudice or any kind of preconception. Yeah. Another one, and that's maybe more standard, but I'm still showing this because it shows kind of the beginning of our kind of material research, is linoleum. That's a lounge for Style Park for the World Architecture Congress in Berlin in 2001. Again, something that's now so common as an architectural language, you know, where all kind of surfaces meld into each other. Here, all the programs, the internet terminals, the storage spaces, the protection walls, everything was kind of part of this kind of continuous landscape. And for us also the first time, and this is like now so standard also in schools, you do these files, you send them to the carpenter. This was the first time we were actually able to do that, where the carpenter had these machines, they put it into their CNC machines and so forth. So that's how, you know, it all started somehow. But again, scale jump. This is a design, is a science center in Denmark, Danfoss Universe. And I show this in context to the Style Park Lounge because it has very similar spatial or like a design strategic ideas. Again, these are stripes or strips. In this case, they're kind of meant as pushed earth that kind of moves up and creates a certain volume, again, that houses all the programmatic needs. And in a way, it was quite helpful to have this kind of extra spaces in the ceiling, or let's say in the space, because that's where we could put all our technical equipment in. So we don't have these you know, extra ventilation ducts and everything on the roof. These overhangs were meant to be vitrines. So far, they haven't used it yet, but Danfoss Universe is a science park that brings, you know, I don't know, issues of technology, science, and so forth, you know, to children mostly. And this one is the temporary exhibition hall. So they change these exhibitions, I think, every 3 months, every 6 months. The beginning exhibition was called Bitlands, so it introduced digital technology to, you know, people or to children. And we were thinking that these overhangs actually could work, you know, as a projection space if they would have Formula One cars inside. They could have maybe one outside, or let's say a silhouette or some projection that would indicate what's going on inside. But since the whole Danfoss Universe is a landscape, it's kind of an open air park, these two buildings are meant to be indoor spaces to expand kind of their business also into the winter months. And there are two buildings. It's the big one here for the exhibitions, and then a small one for a small restaurant. So there's an auditorium inside. And both like long walls, like, you know, side walls, they would be these huge kind of projection walls, and the built-in video cameras, video beamers on both sides would actually shoot onto each other. But what's produced is, you know, you can scan in your face, you could run it through different filters, like very basic issues about digital technology, but quite impressive then with sound in this large space. That's the cafeteria, restaurant. And again, always the idea of like the landscape and the ground kind of being pushed up to create this volume. The roof is bitumen, and it's pretty amazing how precisely it's done in Denmark. I mean, the building technology is really amazing, so detailed. This is a housing project, and now I'm running through a couple of projects that are in the making right now to give you an idea kind of where we attack our kind of thoughts, or how we use our thoughts, you know, in attacking different kind of programmatic issues. This is a housing project for Wohnungsgenossenschaft Carl Zeiss in Jena. That's about 2 hours south of Berlin. And you see these four buildings creating a little court that connects from different sides to the court, and then continue to the market square, which is this kind of square space above. And the buildings, as you see them here, really mark a new anchor between the old kind of medieval part of the town and the 19th century boulevard where they're sitting on. It's more of a, let's say, a set of houses, like a family of objects that are defining the space. And that's, I think, going to be, well, we start construction, I think, end of the year. This one is under construction right now. That's a courthouse in Belgium, in Hasselt, for the region of Limburg. And again, you see ideas where certain, you know, also formal elements from the dining hall, for example, get much more enlarged. So if you, let's say the dining hall, sorry, the dining hall would be about half of the size of the lower part. So it's like an 18-story high-rise that kind of takes this, you know, exploration onto a much higher level and becomes one of the new icon projects for that city. It's based on a master plan by West 8, and we won this competition in a team with two architects, Arzvajo and Lenz Ass from Hasselt. And this is the first building that's now built on this new urban development in the center of the city. Then we just finished a small house that's a kind of a charity project. It's a foundation that built this house for 12 children from social dysfunction families, and the city of Hamburg finances kind of each of the children's kind of staying in that house, and the foundation built that house for that foundation. And that's quite touching because they're so happy that finally somebody really takes care of them and gives them something special while they were suffering most of their life from difficult family situations. This is an apartment in Berlin, 700 square meters, for a couple with two kids and two in-house nannies, where they have an art collection, but she said she doesn't want to have a beige and white apartment like all her girlfriends from Buenos Aires to Alaska. So we gave her some color, and it's again the kind of a sandwich space that really takes the graphic, the super graphic from the floor up to the wall and onto the ceiling. And that should be done in about 2 months. This is a hotel we just finished in Krakow in Poland. In this case, we were only the design consultants in an office, Obot's design lab in Krakow, actually were in charge of like doing all the detailed drawings and all the kind of legal stuff on site. That's an office building which is going to be finished in about 2 months in Hamburg. This is kind of taking reference to the old contour houses with this vertical stripes, constructional stripes, and we kind of inverted by taking those in and pushing the glass out, like this kind of slow moving kind of glass flowing down. But actually it's interesting because it's the smallest facade in Hamburg. It's 1.80 meters on this, 1.60 meters on this side. It was a storage building where with the crane they could actually go to the little canal that was then, you know, in front of the building. And that's what it is right now. I think that's maybe 2 months old, this picture. But in a way it's kind of the smallest facade in Hamburg and therefore already becomes a landmark for the city. This is a design, a housing project, our first building in Berlin, which is quite special for us after like 10 years of being there and doing stuff that's not appreciated by the official kind of building politics of Berlin. This is a house, 25 apartments, that's an L-shaped, this is the like the front view, and then it continues into the back like an L-shaped building. We try to bring a certain landscape idea also into the apartments with like different heights. This is the court, so it has kind of, I think it has kind of a Sao Paulo feeling, you know, when I look at it. But it's really a different kind of model for the housing market in Berlin. This is an office building in Hamburg, and now I'm slowing down a little bit and explaining a little bit more. This one is for the same client we did the other, or we're doing this other office building right now. In this case, again, I'm referring back to this perforated data protection pattern that you saw earlier, where issues of kind of visual penetration or visual availability becomes an issue. And this is, you know, a very kind of standard speculative office building where everything is about like the percentage of like rental space versus, you know, traffic space or something like that. So, you know, every kind of number was really careful. And in a way, what's left is 50 centimeters of facade, you know, to play with or to explore something different. So every rental unit then became this little, or got this little kind of winter garden balcony space that you see. And they come out and allow you to actually walk into the facade and, you know, use it as a kind of wind protected, there's natural ventilation behind, as a wind protected reading area, or maybe have a cigarette or just have a kind of a casual conversation. But there were meant to be moments where in this generic office floor you could have maybe the, you know, the meeting room behind, or the room for the, I don't know, for the director, or some kind of special lounge that, you know, would profit from this relationship to the outside. But also this perforated relief idea that we developed for the facade with these eyes that really look into this beautiful kind of park in front of it and also onto a lake, Alster, then actually came back into different scales. For example, we developed this precast concrete ceiling that, you know, creates a certain relief idea as well. There's no suspended ceiling. Everything we, you know, was kind of managed to be put in different places. So that already kind of gives a completely different spatial idea. We were able to do the furniture because I think 2/3 of that building is occupied now by an advertising agency. It would also go as far as, you know, really designing all the meeting areas, for example. Also then, and this is a little bit difficult to see from the back, but also the material choice here was a round ceramic mosaic that also has this kind of relief idea in a similar formal attitude. And then when you move away, this is the building from outside, when you move away, the client actually offered the city to design or actually pay for the redesign for the park because it was a really rundown, just green, shitty field. And therefore he was allowed to build a little bit more of a square footage for his building. So again, the relationship, the building doesn't stop where the building is. It always kind of reflects to the countries or the landscape in front of it, but also tries to bring that idea into a spatial kind of reality into the inside. And this then the view, again, special moments in the park. This would be kind of raised picnic greens. While, you know, we have the special moments in the facade also as kind of anchors in this kind of open field space. This is a villa, and although it doesn't really look so kind of similar. Was there before, and we called it Dupli Casa, duplicated somehow a found footprint from the building that was there before. The client started to build this house in 1984, and with every child and more money, there was another extension. Conceptually, really interesting. It was a collection of all the materials that were in fashion, from white marble to travertine to, you know, gray granite, from, I don't know, 45 degree angles to, I don't know, some kind of fan-like organic shapes and so forth. Some Tadao Ando-like extensions like the garage and so forth. So it was a real collection of kind of 20 years of architecture. But he didn't like it anymore, but emotionally they were so attached to the house, but he felt it had to go to kind of build something new that would fit his aesthetic ideas. They only dress in black, they only have black cars. There was, from the very beginning, clear the house could be only, there could only be black and white in the whole building. So while we talked, I mean, you can see, you know, all these extensions, like the balcony became kind of a winter garden, and then there was like something built on top of it and so forth. So it's, again, conceptually interesting, it was a nightmare to walk through the space. So we said, and actually this idea was pretty clear from the very beginning, we use the footprint of the existing house as a family archaeology. We keep, also we had to keep some of the concrete because there was so much heavy kind of concrete in, you know, in, it's on a slope in the ground. We duplicated it and lifted it up and rotated it out, so kind of we moved the house out of the like the old footprint. And then, of course, each floor gets their own kind of dynamic. The lower floor is for the children and the pool. The upper floor is for the parents and guests. And then in between, you have the kind of the public spaces, like the living room, dining room, the main kitchen, and the second kitchen, the show kitchen. And, of course, then the views to the beautiful landscape. So this is the entry, and it kind of really sucks you in. This is the outdoor pool, which was there before, which is natural water from the site. So some of the elements were found and partly redesigned, partly we had to keep them. Then here you see kind of the sandwich idea. The lower floor and the upper floor are kind of mirrored. And then in between you have these mediating walls and they start, you know, this kind of organic relationship between the two floors. And again, what looks so kind of continuous and easy as one surface is a highly complex research into all the materials, how to cover this thing. There's a polyurethane coating again for the roof, then there's stucco, then you have polyurethane again where the openings are, where like the weather would hit or the rain would hit the building, and then there's tartan rubber floor for the kind of for the carpet where the building sits on the grass. So again, you know, the engineering that goes into this like very kind of simple design idea becomes such a you know, a challenging part, which needs all the input, but also kind of the the excitement of the companies that really want to kind of push what's possible in terms of building technology right now. And again, I think that also adds, we get confronted quite a bit with questions when these pictures get published. People would, like in blogs would say, oh, this is not built, this is just a rendering and so forth. And I think it's because these normal things are missing. There's no metal flashing on the roof. There are certain things that you would expect, you know, with a real building. And this is just a very early thought, but in a way, I feel maybe our generation grew up where computer renderings were still very kind of abstract and crude. So, you know, we didn't do all like the metal railings, or we didn't do all the kind of the detailing because it was just not possible. So kind of the reality of rendering, maybe now in our times, I'm looking at you because we're a similar generation, now I think maybe reflected back to what our aesthetic realities were or are. And I'm just like starting to think about if there might be some kind of relation between that. So what you see here is the footprint, let's say half of, like on the left side, that's all existing walls, and then the right side, the pool got extended. We had to rebuild some of the walls. Then, of course, the children wanted bigger rooms, so they pushed it out a little bit. But still, it's kind of based on the original footprint. The main kind of floor, which is the entry floor, consists of like four main spaces, kind of radial around the central atrium, and divided, you know, it's always divided by a core that houses a certain program, either the staircase and the elevator, because that should be kind of contained. They didn't want to have an open stair where ministers are there, would go up to the private rooms. There's a chimney, there's a toilet and a wardrobe, the kitchen, and the exposed kitchen next to it, the show kitchen, basically. And then the upper floor is all kind of organized around the central atrium with like private sleeping spaces, bathrooms, guest rooms, and so forth. So here again, the sandwich idea. And all these overhangs then basically come from this confrontation of this rotated floor plans from below and above. Some interior shots. This is the dining room. And in the back, you see the former garage, which now is her atelier for her paintings. And the stone wall is also existing. So some of them are really traces from the house before. This is the main atrium with from the living room. A view from the balcony down to the main living room. We took pictures just like the weekend before they moved in, so we only had some furniture as indicators for the scale. I was there 4 weeks ago, as the second time after they moved in. It doesn't look much different. It's just that they have now some paintings put on like the walls. I think they're still like trying to, I think they have a conflict. Like she likes more kind of Baroque golden furniture and he likes more the cool stuff. So I think there's a kind of a family conflict that's going on there right now. This is the pool. What we photoshopped out is she designed a family logo in Bizzazza and that's on the floor of the pool. But it becomes so dominant that we kind of felt we had to do it. For the pictures at least, we had to take it out. This is the main living room here. And again, the view, how you would see it when you enter it, when you approach it. Okay, now I'm jumping to the kind of most complicated and elaborate project that we are working on right now, Metropole Parasol. And actually, that's a competition we won while I was teaching here in 2004. So actually, we worked in the office while I was teaching and going back and forth. June 2004 was the moment where this one kind of entered the office and was supposed to be done by 2007, and now hopefully it will be done next year. It just becomes so complicated, and it takes, it's not because of, I don't know, there's nobody to blame. It's just such a complicated project. It's the largest timber construction in the world, as we just learned from the timber company and the engineers, Arup. And the scale is just so big. I mean, I'm showing you later some pictures how it's built now, that even like the software programs cannot, are just at the edge of like calculating this thing. Like one iteration to calculate the whole thing takes about 3 weeks. If they find some error or like something that has to be readjusted, it takes another 3 weeks. So that just keeps going and going and going. Seville, close to Portugal, south west in Spain, considered as, let's say, the conservative bigger cities in Spain, launched this competition in 2003 as, I think, the third competition for that site. This is the Red Square in the very center of the medieval downtown, supposedly the largest downtown, medieval town in town center in Europe. And what you see on the upper left, that's the expo site from 1992. The southern half of Seville medieval town center is kind of pretty developed. It has all like the main churches, it has the town hall, it has the shopping areas. And the northern part was somehow a little bit dangerous, not anymore, but it was a little bit of a tricky part of the town. So this site had a crucial function on different scales, really as a kind of a neighborhood thing to bring back certain food market functions that what there was before. Also to work, let's say, on a national level to compete with other Spanish cities, with Bilbao, with Valencia, with Gran Canaria, and so forth. And then, of course, to attract international business and also tourism. So on all these different levels, you know, it had to kind of work. But I think the intelligence of the project happened much earlier because it was initiated as an ideas competition without having the pressure to find a project that would actually work. But then, after the first phase was done and they selected 10 projects to be in the second phase, it became a completely public process. We had to go to Seville and present it to the other competitors. We had to present it to the city. It was in the public forums. We had to ask, we had to respond to questions from the general audience. Everything was on the internet. There was a blog that could actually discuss it. And I think that's when the city felt, because our project was really highly kind of appreciated, surprisingly, and very positively discussed, that there might be a project that has the support also from the people. So it wouldn't make sense to, you know, announce a winner if nobody really feels comfortable with a project like this. But at that point, everybody was already kind of involved in the process, could raise their voice. We looked very carefully to kind of the points that Bert mentioned on also the criticism and tried to see if it would make sense for us or not and how we could adjust or could react to these issues. The site looked like this when we when the competition was running. It was a 6 meter deep hole with ruins from the Roman times, because the city wanted to build a 4-story deep parking garage, and when they put down the 40 meter deep walls and took out the earth, that's what they found after like going down 6 meters. The southern part was the endpoint of, or is the endpoint of a bus line that goes into the center of the city. But this was the market as it was before. So it was actually an object that sat in there in like ripped out medieval fabric. It was never built as a plaza like Plaza Mayors or Plaza Reals with like a homogeneous facade. It's basically small buildings all of a sudden became plaza facades after they took down the food market. This happened in the southern part was taken down in the 50s to create this end bus station. And then the northern part was taken down in the 70s. Just the city grew too much, so they couldn't feed the city from that food market anymore. And then it was temporary parking for about 30 years. And so I think the mayor that's in charge right now, he really wants to be the one who finally like gives back a place and kind of a pulsating, lively part center to the city. So this was the situation, again, for the competition. There were pretty clear areas where you were allowed to go into the ground with foundations, and then some areas which are completely protected. And the competition brief was pretty open. They said they would like to keep the archaeology as an archaeological museum, bring back some food market, like a little market, but more for like a local neighborhood supply, and then think about maybe an icon for the city that would, again, show the innovation or capacity of Seville. So when we entered with our kind of cloud, we were pretty sure that the first element that we have to bring to the site was shadow. Otherwise, we cannot really be outside in this hot climate. And so the first competition we just did, we had some time in the office, and we just played with ideas that were going through our minds that we felt were kind of reasonable for that site. And then in the second phase, we actually went there and tested our first scheme with found situations on site. So this is a square just like 200 meters away from our square, where you see that similar structures, in this case trees, create this shadow and kind of define a space, a public space. Then this was a picture that I still had in mind when I was in Seville for the World Expo. That's the roof of the cathedral. So you have this beautiful undulated stone roof, which is somehow like a flying carpet over the city. And so our kind of reference was to that roof as this undulated kind of, sky. And then, of course, from underneath the structure then becomes kind of the space-defining element. So in a way, we wanted to create an updated version of that cathedral public space, and the dimensions are pretty similar for this square here, Plaza de la Encarnación. So here you see again the layers of the different programmatic programs. It's the archaeological museum 6 meters down. Then you have the food market. And then an elevated plaza, and again here I would like to refer to the Style Park Lounge in the beginning. You see how certain kind of ideas that you test in small installations always come back, kind of course, kind of redesigned or let's say reconfigurated. But in a way, the swelling of the ground to inhabit a program, in this case, is also referenced to certain ideas that you developed in the beginning. And then you have these mushrooms or these parasols that grow up with a restaurant on top and a panoramic walk. Some plants. We established that grid that would help us then to define certain programs like water pools, little ponds, some grass areas, areas for trees, and then of course some of them then become these stems for the power source. On the left plan you see the area which we were not allowed to touch in beige. The right plan shows you the ground plan. This is the restaurant, the beige shape, and then the panoramic walk. The dimensions are quite large. It's 150 meters long, 75 meters wide, and 30 meters high. So it's like a 6-story high building. And it's just a little bit above the houses around it, so you really have a 360-degree view when you're up there. Again, we had to go through all different, after we won the competition, we had to go through all these different kind of committees. And again, I think the intelligence really is in the moderation of the city, how they brought the project to the public. I had to go to schools and present it to students. I had to go to VIP clubs and present it to, like certain interest groups. You had to go to the cultural committee of Andalusia and so forth. So on all different levels, really, we try to be open about the whole project, also listen to what were the concerns and what were the possibilities. And I think that's only why this thing could be built. I could not imagine this thing being built in Germany at this point. So in a way, although construction is completely crazy there, I think that's the only culture, you know, that makes it possible besides maybe China or like some Asian countries. Also what you see in the lower part here, everything that's kind of darker brown, that's either concrete or steel. Everything that's beige is this laminated wood with polyurethane coating that I showed you earlier in the dining hall. And this is, again, not because we wanted it to be in that material, but again, we compared all possibilities. Steel, glass fiber reinforced concrete, wood with coating, without coating, and through all the processes with the city, with the engineers, with the companies, that was always the one that fulfilled the best, all these requirements that you have to look at in terms of cost, security, heat performance, prefabrication, earthquake performance, of course, fire codes, and so forth. So it really was a really complicated selection process. And only because we discovered this technique before, it was possible for us to compare it or to put it into this list of comparing structural elements. And then, you know, it goes step by step to become more detailed. Study pieces on shadows, where we can have certain programmatic areas. Also, it's a public-private partnership project, which means the city was our client until the building permissions. And then afterwards, it's SACIR, which is a huge construction company, which actually makes it quite difficult for us because we deal with the our client is also the company we try to control. Which is just not possible. So in a way, it's always kind of negotiating what they want to build and what we want them to build. And of course, the city wants to have a certain quality. And we felt for a while they were just like retreating and not being responsible for anything that might go wrong. Now they're really back for like the last 6 months, which I think is really helpful because the negotiation is really difficult. The city pays about 30 million euros, and the company pays another 30 million, and then they have 40 years to make profit out of that space before it goes back to the city, and then they can, you know, give it away again for, like, you know, somebody else to make profit. So these are now like early studies how to get this thing done. Here again, you see these huge wood planks, the machines that cut them out, and this is now the latest version how they will build it. We went from maybe 10 different ideas how to get this thing done. For a while, it was like the first pre-stressed or post-stressed, pre-stressed, right? Vorgespannt. Pre-stressed wood construction in the world, where every wood plank would have like holes up on the lower part and upper part with like steel rods, like, you know, being kind of pressured from both sides, until they found out that some areas the pressure was so strong that the wood would just melt away like butter. So they had to find different ways how to construct it. In this case now, this is like really state of the art, actually more than state of the art. The construction now works like this. The joints are steel joints with these forked like 1 meter long steel rods that are glued in with a glue that just has permission, got permission last year in December. And so this is the only way how they could actually get the force kind of distributed well enough so that the wood can actually take it. And the glue has a heat performance up to 80 degrees, which again was kind of how far do we have to go, because, you know, when sun hits it, it might just heat up. But then there were all these studies done, how far does the heat get in, and I think it's only like 4 centimeters, so the rest would be fine for the steel rods and so forth. So, you know, ARP really, you know, with the company Finforestmerk, are really like reinventing every other month how to build this thing. And I can't even listen to it anymore because I get so kind of annoyed. And I've wondered, like, they calculate this for about 3 or 4 years now. And still there's some areas, although we are already under construction, which are not clear how they will build it. And it really means that everybody has to bring in their kind of the most kind of advanced capacity that they can offer. So here you see the first study pieces, the steel rod with the glue and the wood planks and the polyurethane coating. That's kind of as it is hopefully built now. And also then there are like certain regulations that the steel has to be a lower quality than the glue, because in case there's a collapse of material, it has to be the steel and not the glue and so forth. So that all these kind of tricky issues. These were earlier versions with the pre-stressed joints where you'd have to join and then there would be a hole that runs, you know, from one joint to the other inside the wood. And there are all these tests about how to performances, stress performance and so forth. Again, back to the nice part, the sculptural ideas. you know, this is kind of how we imagine the space now really becoming the lively center for, and of course nobody wants to know these things later. You know, that's just, you know, it's important how these things kind of then perform on an urban level. And that's maybe just like the secret behind to get this done. So these are pictures, and you see the two cores now for the elevators for the restaurant platform. That's done in steel and concrete, and we have to have this because of fire issues. And also kind of stiffness for the overall structure. What's interesting is that you're not only kind of dealing with logistics that are part of just the normal process of developing it and, you know, dealing it and dealing with the archaeologists and so forth, but of course you deal with political logistics. In this case, the platform had to be up 2 years ago on Easter. It didn't make sense in the whole like production construction process. But the mayor wanted to be reelected, and it worked out. So he really wanted to have this thing up to, you know, give a speech 2 weeks before the thing. And this is like a week before. There are religious logistics. This is like Semana Santa, the week before Easter, where the whole city shuts down, and they only have these processions going through the whole city. So we had to take down a crane. We had to actually remove the construction site. So the main street with the old traditional procession would go through. And that's my favorite picture, actually. The crosses on our columns had to be done. So you see the cables to lift up the platform. It took like 10 hours to move it from up to, and I go one picture back, and then they put these styrofoam steel beams, and they had to be kind of spiral because that's when the stair goes in to go up. But this is, I think, a genius picture that we got sent from somebody in Israel. And then, of course, you get pictures how the project gets developed. This is the circle in the front. That's the southern, the most southern footprint for the parasol. It spans across the bridge, that street that, you know, now is open again. This was where the procession went through. Then the platform for the restaurant. There's like an upper platform. Then further up, you see like the top height there for the skywalk later. You see the Friendel structure on the lower part that spans across the archaeological site. And here, this is the level what you will see on the restaurant level. And just to give an example to make this kind of financially, how they consider this thing financially, the Giralda Tower has about 2 million visitors a year, and they charge every visitor €2 to go up and down. So they calculate something similar to the parasol, which makes already 4 million just by people walking up and down. And then, you know, they have like restaurants and so forth. So it's a really, you know, and it had to be like, I don't know, attractive enough to go up there, but it could, you know, so people would have a view, but it couldn't be too high because the cultural committee of Andalusia would be scared that, you know, it would affect too much of the skyline. So it's constantly negotiation between different interest groups. This is a Renaissance church, very close. Again, in Germany, this would never happen, I'm pretty sure. You see, like these are the beginnings of the wood construction. The footprints are done in a different way. You have these U-shaped steel elements, you know, which put these things together. That's how it slowly starts to kind of create the final shape. And here you see also the scale jump again from the small buildings around to the structure. And you get already an idea of this organic kind of movement that goes all the way up. This there is one of the big three stairs that go up to the elevated plaza. And again, you know, you draw something which you think is kind of state of the art, like a normal, you know, concrete slope with, you know, stairs. In Spain, they build it in a very different way. They just build a slope and then they have little bricks and they cut them, you know, to little triangles and glue them on, which we hope it will hold up. But that's the way how they build it. There was like the guy who came from the timber company said, "Oh, I didn't know you had to include historic fragments into your project." So we have these kind of metal and concrete covers at the bottom because of fire issues, so the wood can only start from 5 meters up. So in case there's a car burning in, like underneath one, it has to be protected. That is beautiful, huge kind of steel, undulated steel bands that wrap the lower part of the building and go all the way down into the archaeology. This is the archaeology, and they found pretty interesting things. I mean, nothing too spectacular, but really beautiful old mosaics from Roman times, an oyster factory, an oil lamp factory, a basilica with two and so it will be really an interesting site to go there, but also for the history of Seville, it's more or less kind of where the city started to, when it was founded. So there would be a suspended ceiling. The archaeologists took all like walls out, they would bring it back. They still like, it's kind of, it remains an in-progress archaeology museum. So while the market already is up there, they will keep digging and finding things. So it really, I think it's really lively and active on all levels. And then they bring these wood pieces, and for us, who still kind of grew up with French curves and stencils, it really feels like you're a miniatured person walking, you know, on your drawing board. And they're really incredible, beautiful when they lie down with these curves. This will be the walkway upstairs. You see the restaurant, which will be in this kind of calzone-like space where it has a cover. This is a view from the inside to the city. And I think this is an important picture because it shows kind of the simultaneity of present, history, and future. You have the view down to the archaeology. You have kind of the ground floor as the everyday market. And then, you know, these parasols that take you up, and you have this beautiful view to the horizon. And what I think is really important, you have different levels and different kind of pockets in this public square for different programmatic situations. In this case, the elevated plaza could become, you know, a closed-off area for a concert. You could have maybe a tango festival or flamenco festival. You could have a car show, something, you know, that also, again, brings profit to the city and also to the people who run that place, while the main plaza still remains open. You can completely, like, walk around. So all these kind of new forms of how public spaces have to be used or will be used, the reality of kind of nowadays economic situations of cities, I think work really well on these different kind of levels for the project. And then what's a real gift, and I'm done in a second, what's a real gift in Seville is that in Spanish cultures, you know, at 2 o'clock at night, it might be more lively at 2 in the afternoon. If we try in Germany to really bring people onto the streets and, you know, celebrate public spaces, it's just kind of a natural condition. And therefore, we really hope that to bring, you know, a new situation and a kind of a lively, pulsating heart back to Seville. I'm showing just some kind of detailed images, and by fading out again, to bring you back to my first and main obsession, these patterns, how they also kind of always reappear and remain in the background when we design something and find this kind of universe of structures, two-dimensionality, playing into the 3 dimensions and 4 dimensions, keeping a certain graphic quality also in the build work that kind of anchors us back to kind of the found sources that are always the starting point that we are dealing with. So I'm thanking you for coming, listening to 10 years of production. That's only the happy side of 10 years. And next time I maybe talk about the non-happy side. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Jurgen. If there are any questions, there's a microphone, so please don't be shy. Now is the moment to find out how to succeed in architecture if you need any tips.
Just smile.
Well, maybe I started off with one question I have. I think there is an obsession that you haven't really addressed clearly, but that is kind of hidden there, which is this erasure of any sort of joint or seam, even in wood construction. I mean, I was astonished to now see those construction details in Seville, because, you know, usually in wood construction is where you celebrate the joint, where you would express it. You mentioned something about those early forms of rendering, the dematerialized renderings, which were just color and light, and today we have texture mapping. Do you think it comes from there, or is that something else that, you know, how can you explain your obsession with the dematerialized surface?
I think I like, I look at architecture more in an abstracted way and in a sculptural way. So the way how to put things together don't really interest me so much. I look more into an overall atmosphere that contains one all-inclusive environment that that deals with light, with sound, with haptic issues. What I didn't say with the town, with the dining hall, when you see the kind of the rubber-like gum gram with this idea of an elastic space, what was really beautiful by bringing this polyurethane coating into the construction, somehow accidentally, it remains a kind of a soft surface. So the rubber idea or this elastic idea really becomes a haptic reality also for the building. And so the idea of kind of putting things together and seeing the addition is less interesting to me than looking at an overall kind of synthesis of things.
So like Corbusier had the loaf ripple, you have the loaf polyurethane.
Maybe, yeah.
Maybe that's the next book.
That's my next lecture.
Are there any questions?
Sorry, maybe I didn't put attention enough, but how big are the sheets of plywood that you use or the wood you use to make those big columns?
Yeah, in this case, I think there's a seam between the stem and then when it goes out, the parasols. But I think they're up to, 15 meters long. That's what they can put on trucks from Germany to Spain. The company is near. Yeah. The company is outside of Munich, and they have about 265 trucks calculated to run every 3 days from Munich to Seville. So it's, again, logistics. They really know exactly which pieces on which truck, you know, from Munich to Seville. And that's the only company who actually can produce it that way. And the limit is basically the trucks. But they come in 40 meter long sheets, 2 by 40 meters.
Any other questions?
Oh no.
It's clear that you're a great architect, and I was wondering about your role as an architect, I mean, creating great buildings. But you also seem to be actually collaborating with companies to develop new technologies, new materials. Is that actually going to be becoming part of your practice explicitly, or is it just sort of a byproduct of your practice?
Well, as I mentioned before, we are forced to develop these new technologies because we are so innocent when we design things. You know, we are not like, oh, you can't do that to wood, or a concrete building has to look like this. We really deal with, if let's say the smaller installation work comes from looking at a certain material or like a certain condition and exploring the potential of that, then the buildings work the other way around. It's more like trying to look at the space and the atmosphere we want to create and then try to find the right material and construction. And that actually changes even like in the process of like building something. The villa looks like this homogeneous thing, but actually it's a concrete core. Then she didn't want to have concrete on the sleeping on the sleeping floor, so that has to be in brick. The roof is actually in wood construction. Then it's like put on concrete, poor concrete elements, which are up to 60 centimeters and 80 centimeters deep. That's all kind of sanded and with done with stencil. So it's actually really kind of massaged into shape in a way, the whole building. But again, we did all different kinds of material researches. For a while, the building, like the company who did the surface on the outside, they proposed a stucco that had to be with a waxing coating, and the building had to be re-waxed every 3 years. And then we built like a sample wall, and it looked so dirty and really ugly after 2 weeks already because all the leaves and the dust would actually stick on the wax. And so that was kind of, then they had to propose something else. But usually, yeah, we need the companies really to, but also that we do the research too. I mean, we go from magazines, we talk to companies, and so forth. So it's just part of the reality now.
Okay, one more.
Good question. Regarding the kind of the extraordinary Duple Casa project, maybe you could just talk a little bit more about, or at least I was quite interested in the kind of process of transformation from the old house to the new house. And I mean, was it just, in a sense, I'm kind of interested in how the domestic space was reorganized in the new proposal.
Well, I don't know if I can go back now. Well, we actually just took the footprint of the house. and the outline, and that's more or less the starting point. We had to take some of the fragments of the foundations, but more like the technical rooms and part of the swimming pool. It was clear, and this was kind of like that before, the children were in the basement on the lower floor, the parents were in the upper floor. So we actually kept kind of the layering of the spaces as it was before. But then we introduced the central atrium space, which was in the beginning like the highest point with a column, and then radial like kind of fan-like structural elements that would kind of go from there. But we replaced that central column with like a void